Thank you for that beautiful music, Gayla. And good morning. Welcome to everyone. We're so glad you're here to worship our God with us. Future alignment vote for Victory Memorial Methodist Church is tonight at 6 p.m. in the sanctuary. We will vote as a church on whether or not to stay independent or join the Global Methodist Church. Please make plans to attend. If you cannot be there, votes may be emailed to the church office no later than today. Ladies Bible Study will begin their new study titled Just Open the Door by Jen Smith next week. The Wednesday evening group will start on August the 30th at 6, and the Thursday morning group on August the 31st at 10. Both down in the fellowship hall. Books are available in the church office for $16. This is open to all ladies in town. They'd love for you to join them.
Yes.
Loaves and Fishes Workday. Our church not only contributes food and money to Loaves and Fishes throughout the year, but September is also our month to volunteer at the food pantry. 8 helpers total are needed every Tuesday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. This is a fantastic opportunity to support a neighborhood ministry. Find the sign-up sheet at the back of the sanctuary. Methodist Men's Breakfast, every Wednesday morning,
yes, sir,
from 6:30 to 7:30 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Bring a friend and come and join us for good food, fellowship, and devotion. License plates. There are free Guymon for Christ license plates at the back of the sanctuary for anyone to take. Grab one on your way out.
Yes.
And visitors, please leave your contact information on one of the visitor cards found in your pew. Pastor Dave would like to follow up with you and thank you for being here. And the newsletter. If you'd like to receive our twice a month newsletter, please get in touch with the church office so we can get you added to the mailing list. Daily devotions. Pastor Dave encourages everyone to enjoy a quiet time with God each day.
Yes.
And all the bells, the bell choirs and all other choirs will begin Wednesday, September the 6th. And Sandy would love to see you.
Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Now join me in our call to worship. Come unto me, and I will give you rest.
Freely have received, Lord Jesus, so we live freely and joyfully.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
Freely have received, Lord Jesus, so we live freely and joyfully.
I am gentle and humble in heart.
Freely we have received, Lord Jesus, so we live freely and joyfully.
I will give you rest for your souls.
Freely we have received, Lord Jesus, so we give freely and joyfully.
Love one another as I have loved you.
Freely we have received, Lord Jesus, so we give freely and joyfully.
Continue meeting together for prayer, study, worship, and fellowship.
Freely we have received, Lord Jesus, so we give freely and joyfully. Almighty God,
we surrender our lives to you. Help us to support each other spiritually and to watch over each other in love.
Now let us prepare our hearts to worship our Lord.
Let's all stand together and sing, Go Make of All Disciples.
Friends. seated. Really nice to see each of you with us this morning. Balcony is almost full up there. Woohoo! Welcome each of you to worship, Denise. Welcome. Zach, I see you. Amber, I see you. Welcome to worship. Remember, this is God's idea. He's the one who draws us. He's the one who longs to hear us sing his praise. Give him thanks for his goodness. Respond in an intimate relationship to his invitation to be a part of the family. I hope you will experience the power and the presence of God today in a life-giving and life-changing way. Our theme today is the theme of life groups. And of course, these life groups are called many different names. Some have called them cell groups. Some churches and some small gatherings have called them reunion groups or home groups or study groups or infinity groups. Lots of different names. A special relationship, a special covenant gathered around Christ and what it means to be a disciple. So I really pray that as we dig in today, you would hear God calling you into a deeper relationship and to be a part of one of those, maybe even to lead one of those. Wouldn't that be exciting? That God would raise up right here among us leaders that would care for the souls of others. This is my prayer. Join me in unison as we pray the prayer in your bulletin or up on the screen. Lord Jesus, Son of the living God, we are so thankful that you are willing to become one of us and then agree to die on the cross to save us. We marvel at the way you made friends, recruited your disciples, and how you equipped them to love others and share the gospel. Please help us to connect intimately with you and empower us to forge deep and lasting faith friendships with other Christians. Help us all to belong to a life group that will nurture us, support us, and equip us for life, ministry, and godliness. Word of God, teach us. Church of God, mature us. And Spirit of God, lead us into all truth and holiness, we pray. Amen. As the ushers come forward, we'll receive tithe, offering, and faith promise gifts this morning. Our stewardship reflection comes out of Mark chapter 12, reading from verse 41. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins with only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others." I think they must have had a big question mark on their face when he said that, huh? What did she give? Well, just a couple of cents. Really? They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. Together. Lord, what a privilege it is to be in worship today. We remind ourselves that we have come from you. You are our creator. Your fingerprints are all over our lives, each one of us. And each one of us is on our way back to you. There is a divine appointment that awaits each of us. And Lord, we want to get to know you and love you and serve you and be ready when our time comes to graduate. Thank you for this opportunity to return a small portion to you of all you have blessed us with. We give because we have received from you. We love because you have first loved us. Lord, we serve because you have shown us how. Please bless the gift and the giver. Use Victory Memorial to be a bright, shining Christ light for you, a blessing center where you are shared generously with others. We pray it in your name. Amen.
Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you or the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. And now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Try me, Lord. If you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you, maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. And now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
Me, let us sing our doxology together. You may be seated. We are blessed this morning to have our chancel choir with us, and they're going to sing Purify My Heart.
Is to be holy.
Children will come forward at this time. We will have a children's moment together. Children of all ages, welcome. Boy, is it good to see you all back with us today. How was the summer? Good, but it's over, right? Now it's school, school, school. Yay! Woohoo! We hope that you're going to have a great school here, that you're going to learn and grow, have good friends. We pray that the Lord is going to guide you so that your relationship gets deeper and stronger each week. That is our prayer, and we've been praying. For the last couple of weeks, we've been praying for you as students, praying for the teachers, praying for all of those that help you, bus drivers, those that help serve you lunch. We pray that you have a wonderful school year, very, very successful. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about life groups. So I must ask you an important question. Who do you have that you are able to talk to, pray with, maybe study God's word? Together. Do you have a friend? Any friend that you can do that with? Maybe a friend from school or maybe one from church here, that from this part of God's family. Maybe it's your mom and dad. It's very important that we find people to do that with. We want you to read your Bible by yourself. We want you to do some praying by yourself. But we also want you to pray with others. We want you to study God's word with others. We want you to worship together with others. And you need to learn to do that now. Don't wait. Look for ways to do that. So I pray that God will give you a faith friend to do that with. That's a wonderful gift, or maybe two or three or four or five. We're praying that for the college students, to see them sitting out there, college students. We're praying that God will give them faith friends and a life group that they can grow and share and enjoy life with. Life is better with a life group. When I was a new Christian, I was 17 years old, I knew very little about the Bible. I knew nothing about prayer, really, other than when I was really in trouble, I'd quickly fire up a prayer to God like an arrow. God, please get me out of this mess. That was about as much praying as I did. Once in a while, I try to be very religious. Before I went to sleep, Carrie, real tired. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. I quickly rattled off that prayer. I thought, I've done good. I've given God what he deserves. Now I can go to sleep. I was mistaken. That is not what God was looking for. But when I became a new Christian, I had a friend. He became my youth pastor. And he and I, we studied together, we prayed together. He bought me my first Bible dictionary. He bought me Haley's Bible handbook. He showed me how to use a concordance to look up words. Then he bought me a concordance. He prayed for me. And we worshiped together. We did mission. We went to youth group. And guess what happened, Raimi? I grew, because I had people to share with and grow with. And you will too. If you're not growing, guess what's happening? You're dying. If you're not growing as a Christian, you're dying. Or maybe you're dead already, spiritually dead. Maybe there's nothing real there. You know, if you don't keep growing, if you don't keep watering, you wilt and you die. That's why it's so important to be a part of friendships and groups that help you to grow. So guess what the pastor wants? I'm glad you asked, Oakley. He wants every one of you to have a faith friend or two or three. He wants every one of you to be in a group where you are supported and encouraged so that you become a strong, vital Christian. Very important. And there are all kinds of groups that do that. Bible study groups, Sunday school groups, choirs like we had here. They friends that go and do things together. Maybe it's a mission group, or maybe even it's like a motorcycle club. You know, there are motorcycle clubs who ride big Harley Davidsons, but they're Christians and they read God's word and they pray together and they do missions together. It can be all kinds of groups, but who's at the middle? God is at the middle. God is the center. God's word is a part. Worship is a part. So we want that for you, okay? We want you to have, if you don't have a friend like that, I want you to start praying. God, give me a friend like that, that I can share my faith with, that we can grow together. You know what the Bible says, Chris? Iron sharpens iron, like a file that files a blade, until it's got a sharp edge. Barrett, are you sharp? I hope so. Griff, are you sharp? I hope so. Dave Player, are you sharp? Lord, get that file. Put an edge on me. I want to be sharp for you. Let's pray. Lord, for our children, we love them. Give them a great school year. But more than that, give them a faith friend that they can share with, pray with, read and study your word with. Grow them big and strong as Christians. We ask in your sweet and beloved name. And everybody said, no, loud. Everybody said,
amen.
Amen. You got it. You go. There'll be candy waiting for you. I don't think I can preach today. I just heard in Sunday school that Isaac and Jonathan are fishing out there in Colorado, I think on one of those lakes. I don't think I can preach. If they're fishing, I want to be there. I want to be fishing. I'm all sad. Right, Barrett? We should be there with them, right? But I'm going to preach anyway. God bless their fishing. I hope they have a wonderful, successful fishing trip. Join me in our prayer for illumination this morning as we ask God to make the scriptures come alive and speak to us, each of us individually today. Lord, open our hearts and our minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy and obey with gladness what you say to us today. Amen. The scripture today comes out of Romans, the 12th chapter. And I remind you that Paul has said a lot before this 12th chapter, but this is a powerful chapter and nearing the end of the letter. And this whole chapter, Paul is focusing on what it's going to look like if you really become a true follower of Jesus, a devoted disciple, someone who's growing and maturing and serving alongside of Jesus. So there are a couple of things that happen before you get to chapter 12. But now chapter 12 is assuming that you already are a believer, that you already committed your life to follow Jesus, that you are growing as a disciple. And listen to what he has to say in this 12th chapter. Therefore, and that goes all the way back to the previous chapters, therefore, in light of all the things I've said up until now, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, nobody's excluded, every believer, to every one of you, do not think of yourselves more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere, and I must pause there. As we follow Christ, He helps us to become transparent, honest. We're not trying to kind of fit in. He fits us in. He connects us. We're not posing. We're not putting on masks. We become the people God created us to be. We get accepted and loved and supported for who we are. And I pray that that will happen more and more in your life and in mine. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. We were at the OPSU moving in day yesterday, and in one of the conversations we were having, a comment was made. Now, there's somebody that's on fire for God. I hope that's you. Carrie, Monty, Tom, Benny, each of us, may your fire, your love for God be obvious. May people see it, that you're somebody that God has touched and changed and filled with His love, and that you're burning. It is said of Mr. Wesley that he said that God has worked in his life in such a wonderful way that he burns with love for God, and people come to see him burn. When he gets up and preaches, or he gets up and shares God's love, they come to see that fire. May people see that fire in you and me. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, your fire, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. This is the word of the Lord. You'll find in your bulletin at the back a couple of questions that you can think about today while we are examining the scripture together. And maybe you can speak to someone about them. It's good to have conversation with another person, your husband, your wife, your family, friends. Maybe over lunch you can talk about them. Have you ever belonged to a life group that supported your faith, your family, and your interests? What was that relationship, or if there were more than one, what were those relationships and experiences like? What was it like belonging? What was it like being accepted? What was it like being supported and nurtured in your faith? Number two, are you growing, maturing, and equipping your faith and ministry right now? What is working well in your discipleship and your sanctification? And where could you use more support and help? You've got to take inventory on your own life. God wants to sanctify you and me through and through, body, soul, and spirit. He wants to grow us to look more and more like Jesus. How's that going? How are you doing? And if it's not going well, what do you need to get to where God wants you to be? Number three, are you willing to participate in and or lead a life group? This will benefit you and allow you to help and serve others. Our Methodist heritage is fascinating for a lot of different reasons. I'm going to mention a few today. That John and Charles grew up kind of Christian, but they had to find their way into a deep, spiritually alive relationship with God. They knew a lot about the Bible. They'd heard a lot of sermons. They'd attended a lot of worship services. But that real fire only happened for them later on as young adults. Along the way, they saw some of that. They heard about some of that, but it didn't really happen in them. And both of them became leaders, helping others, serving others. But still, there was a lack of fire in their lives. A fiery love for God. Donna, this is what I call it. Falling madly, deeply in love with God. Every one of us has got to find that. And God is helping us get there. But for some of us, it takes a long time. Some get it as children, some as teenagers, some in the young adulthood. Some, they get gray head before they find it. Not that they don't know about God, not that they haven't learned stuff about God, not that they haven't participated some in the things of God. But truthfully, they couldn't get up and say, listen, I'm madly in love with God. I'm sold out to God. My whole life is centered and focused on Him. So one of the things that is so refreshing about Methodism is you've got these two brothers and some friends who found that. They found how to fall in love with God and how to grow in that relationship. And when it happened in them, they started helping others get there. They were like mission possible. They suddenly discovered how refreshing and good this was, how important this was, and they devoted their whole lives to helping others find that. What were they trying to do? They were not trying to start a church. They were not trying to build their own little kingdom. They were not trying to get wealthy. All the regular earthly pursuits were really not important to them. What was most important was that people would connect with God. And out of that connection, they would learn to love God. And they would grow holy, which is not kind of self-righteous. It's just somebody who lives very close to God and tries to be the very best person they can be, the person God created them to be. I call it this: being the best you can be, the best version of you, the God created you. Mr. Wesley wanted everybody to find that. He called it perfect love, to find perfect love. Loving God, God loving you, loving others, living that kind of life. We call it, Vicky, the good life. And it's not this worldly good. It's the one that you read of in the Bible, that kind of good. The kind of life God wants for every one of us. So the early Methodists and the Wesleyans, they discovered this and they shared it with others. But in the beginning, they didn't do very well, Monty. They wanted to do well, but they were messing things up. Trying hard, but messing up. John especially. So he grew up in buildings, worshiping God, Bible studies, youth and all of that stuff, whatever they were doing back then. And he thought, that's where you do it. You know, it's like having a garage at home. That's where you park your car or you keep all your toys. But you just keep it there. You don't go anywhere else. That's where it belongs. And so when God tried to get him out of the garage, he said, oh no, a garage is the place to do this. And God said, no, I want you to go out there in the fields. And he thought, the fields? They'll think I've lost my mind. That's not a good place to do worship. That's not a good place to read the Bible or teach people how to be Christians. But God insisted, and he went out into the fields, and there, as he started sharing the good news, people started to listen. A lot better than they did in the church. A lot better than they did in the building. They started feeling God's presence. They started weeping. Some started to shake. Some even fell down. At first he was thinking, what the heck is going on? He didn't like that because he's English. We like order. We like things done properly. This, Brooke, is not proper. You should know how to behave when you're around God. But all of a sudden he realized, hey, who am I to tell people how they've got to respond when they're around God? If God makes you cry, then cry. If God makes you shake, then you shake. If God makes you fall down on the ground, hallelujah, fall on the ground, okay? But make sure it's your connection with God, God's presence. And so, after a while, he got comfortable being in the fields or wherever. Didn't have to be a churchy building. Could just be a hall. Could be in somebody's home. He didn't care where it was. As long as God's presence was there. As long as people were encountering God and their lives were being changed. Ozzy, this was very important. You must be changed. If you come who you are and you leave the same way, something was lost. Something didn't happen. When we're around God, we change, and we change for the better. We improve. And Mr. Wesley was passionate about seeing people improve in God. And he would try everything he could to help them get there. In the beginning, Deb, he failed. So he would go out in the fields and he'd preach, and people would cry and people would get convicted. People would make a decision for Jesus. But then he'd leave. He'd come back. Guess what? He couldn't find those people. They didn't grow. They didn't mature. They didn't stay with it because they had nobody to care for them. That became very painful for Mr. Wesley. This is what he said. I awakened those people. I got them born again, if you will, and they were murdered. They were killed. Little babies born into God's kingdom. And when I went back, we couldn't find them. They'd been murdered. It was that graphic for him. God gave these people spiritual life, but there was nobody to care for them, and they're dead. They're murdered. I'd rather not preach. If I can't help people stay alive, I don't want to preach. It became agonizing for him. God is moving, people are getting saved, but then they are dying. And then something happened. You see, out of that failure, God showed Mr. Wesley something. They built a building, just an ordinary little preaching house, like a little hall, but they didn't have much money. So he said, we've got to find a way to pay for this building. So he said, you know, maybe it'll be a good thing if everybody could give a penny a week. Now, a penny went a lot further than a penny today, okay? One penny a week. One of the members said, a penny? Some of our people can't pay a penny. Now, you're pretty poor if you can't pay a penny, right? But there are people who can't. Maybe in today's language, it might be a dollar. Maybe it'd be $10. We want every member to give $10. Well, there's some who can't give $10. So one of the members said, but I've got an idea. How about I take 5 or 6 or 10 and I visit with them every week and I ask him for the penny. Kerry, you got your penny? Yeah, I got my penny. How about Steve, has he got? No, he doesn't have a penny. Well, I will chip in for anybody who doesn't have a penny. So if I can only get 5 or 6 out of the 10 I've got, I'll put the other 4 or 5 pennies in. Wesley said, boy, that's a good idea. I think that'll work. So they divided all the people up that were serious about following Jesus, and they got leaders. Who are the leaders? I'm glad you asked, Austin. You. Ramey, you. You don't have to be extra special. You don't have to have a college education. You don't have, Vicky, you don't have to have all the answers. You've just got to be available, and you've got to be willing to do your best. So they got leaders and they went around and they collected the pennies. Some didn't have pennies. You got your penny, Dark Knight? No? Okay, I'm going to put your penny in for you. But something wonderful happened. Out of that strange beginning, they started seeing people had needs. They started listening to each other. They started praying for each other. They started to read a little bit of God's word. And all of a sudden, out of an accident, Mr. Wesley said, this is what we've been missing. We've got to have these little life groups where there's a leader and they meet together and they talk together and they pray for each other. And if you're messing up, you're going to have to confess your sins. What? Yeah. Because you're not ever going to do better unless you can confess and get over your problems. But we're not yet to pick on each other. We're yet to help each other. We're yet to care for one another. If you keep messing up, we want you to do better. If you don't know what to do, we're going to tell you what to do. We're going to grow you until you become that person God wants you to be. We're not giving up until you grow. We want every person to grow. We want every person to mature. So I must stop. I must ask you today, how are you growing? If God gives you a little inventory, a little evaluation, what is he going to say? How are you doing? Are you growing? Are you maturing? Are you doing okay? And then he's going to ask, and how are you helping others? Because it's not just for you. This is too good to keep it just for you. You've got to share it with others. Almost by accident, these Methodists became fiery evangelists because God was doing something so wonderful in their lives, they couldn't help but share it with others. You didn't have to twist their arm. You've got to come to worship, man. You've got to go to a class meeting. Oh, no. They wanted to flee from the wrath to come. They wanted to discover the wonderful, rich, abundant life that God had in store for them. So wherever they went, the fire started spreading. Man, you couldn't stop it. Sometimes they'd throw stones at those early Methodists. Sometimes they'd say all kinds of hateful things. They'd cuss them out. But you couldn't stop them. The fire was burning. You know why? It comes from God. It's not something that is self-generated. You don't get there by yourself. They were together. They were in God's word. They were praying. They were supporting each other. And all of a sudden, man, it was like wildfire. Almost by accident. Listen to me. Out of failure. Mr. Wesley preached, people getting saved, then they're dying. Mr. Wesley's discouraged, doesn't know what to do. God says, if you let me show you, I'll show you what to do. And then they started calling them Methodists because they were doing things in such a organized, predictable, structured way. And they used that to mock them. These Christians that call themselves Methodists, they're way too serious. They're way too disciplined. They're going overboard. One day, Mr. Wesley was asked, will you tell us what a Methodist is? He thought long and hard, and then he wrote a long article. And this is what it said. We're not special Christians. We're just people trying to be Christians. Bible Christians. You see, this is what Jesus did. He met people. He made friends. He called them to hang out with him. They did. He taught them how to connect with God and grow in God. And then he said, now I want you to go and do the same with others. But the church along the way forgot how to do that. The church has forgotten how to disciple. Are you kidding? No, I'm not kidding. We talk about that word, but we don't know what that means. We don't do it. Vicky, you cannot be a disciple if you aren't connected to other Christians. And you can't connect, yeah, just like this in worship. This is good, but this is not enough. You've got to develop friendships, deep faith friendships. You've got to know each other. You've got to help each other. You've got to pray for each other. And when you're messing up, and Mackenzie, we do mess up. Listen, folks, if you think I'm perfect, you're very mistaken. I'm not. I mess up. But a Christian is somebody big enough and secure enough to say, I messed up. Please forgive me. Help me. I want to do better. And we help each other do better. And we get close. And we grow. That's what the Bible teaches. That's what the New Testament is full of. But the church forgot how to do that. They thought it was just about paying some money or going to a worship service once in a while. Maybe if you're really religious, you can go to communion. It was never meant to be that. This was intimate relationship with God. This was caring and connecting with one another, serving together. So Jesus gives his final instructions after he's been crucified, his dead body placed in the tomb. 3 days later, big surprise, he comes back to life. Nobody is ready for that. They are all shocked. It's impossible. Brooklyn, nobody comes alive when they've been killed the way Jesus is killed. Impossible. Somebody has said, when they were finished with Jesus, his body was so badly damaged he looked like hamburger meat. And then he was crucified. And then he hung there and he died. And then they poked the spear into his side. Mackenzie, he's good and dead. Three times over. And then he comes back to life. This must be a ghost. This is not humanly possible. You're right, it's not. Unless, Jeremy, unless this Jesus really is God. And they've got to wrap their mind around that. Is he really God? Because God could do that, but only God. And when they finally come to peace with that, boy, they're on fire. They are praying. They are seeking. They are ready for what God has next. And Becky, you know what God has next. He pours out his spirit and he fills their empty hearts. And then, if they thought they were on fire before, now the fire is burning uncontrollably. People are gathering and the word of God is being preached and people are coming to saving faith. And then they're being discipled. Who's discipling them? I'm glad you asked, Monty. Those people who'd been praying before, now they're the ones teaching. Curtis, you cannot be a believer and not be a teacher. You are always teaching, whether you know it or not. You are an example. You're either a good example, Sadie, or a bad example. But you're an example. If you claim the name of Jesus, if you say, I'm a Christian, you're an example. You're a teacher. And Jesus said this, all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto me. Now I want you to go. Who, me? Yes, you. Aspen, you. You. Every one of us. Lauren, you. But I don't have all the answers. I don't know. I will be with you. I want you to go and make disciples. And I want you to baptize. And I want you to teach them everything that I've taught you. Everything. Yeah. How are they going to know unless you teach them? So what does that mean? Gay, I'm glad you asked. It means you are a disciple maker. And you are somebody who helps somebody get baptized. And you are somebody who teaches others. Every one of us. We've fallen into error. Joanne, you might ask, what's the error? We think there is Christianity without discipleship. Discipleship is not a requirement for you to be a believer. Just believe in Jesus and make a decision, it's all good. No, it's not. That's just the start. Believing in Jesus is just how you begin the conversation, the relationship. Then you've got to grow. And Jesus said, you know how you grow? You become a disciple. You get baptized. And then you get taught, trained, equipped to do all the things that Jesus trained and equipped his disciples to do. So when they told the Wesleys, now listen, you're all going way overboard. This is too much. No, it's not. Just read the Gospels and you'll see this is what they did. We're not extra special. We're just trying to be what Jesus said we need to be. So here's the challenge. You need to find a faith friend or two or three. You need to find a group that you belong to where we talk about Jesus, where we read God's word, where we pray together, where we help each other. And when we're messing up, where we can own it. Those Methodists, they were pretty fierce. They would ask each other, so where have you sinned this week? You want to know about my sins? Yes, I do. Why? You want to pick on me? No. I don't want you to sin. I want you to live right in that sweet spot with God. How can we help you? Where are you struggling? Where have you been tempted? And were you able to overcome the temptation, or did you fall prey again? He has a question they'd ask. A little embarrassing. What are you trying to keep secret? There's a saying, you are as sick as your secrets. If you've got a secret life that's not in the light, then we need to confess it so we can get out of that mess and walk joyfully and freely in the light. So why were those life groups so important? Because they brought change. They brought growth. They brought joy. They developed a vital Christianity that you couldn't stop. You couldn't shut it down. Right at the end of his life, George Whitfield, who was a better preacher than John Wesley, we believe he had more success outdoors and in big crowds than John Wesley, but this is what he said. He said, when I look at John Wesley and how God used him, I realized that my ministry was a sand rope. Have you ever tried to pull a sand rope? You make a rope in the sand and you pull it. Does it come anywhere? No, it just falls apart. And he said, the difference between John Wesley and me is God used both of us and many people came to faith, but Mr. Wesley discovered the class meetings. And he insisted on the class meetings. And their people grew in discipleship. Their people became viable. Their people are serving God. And now, years later, Mr. Wesley has all the fruit and I have very little. God used me and many came to a decision, but not to discipleship. So listen to me today. There is no Christianity without discipleship. There are no solo Christians. It's not just about you and me walking into the sunset with Jesus and all is well. It is not well. You must be connected to the body. There are no living fingers living all by themselves. There are no living toes or eyes. Pluck your eye out and put it next to you and see how long it lasts. A couple of days are going to be stinking dead. It needs to be in your body. Your finger needs to be on your hand. Your toe needs to be on your foot. We belong together. And you can't find that unless you connect with other believers, unless you are growing in a small group. So here's a couple of challenges. If you are so independent that you cannot relate to others, that you cannot share your joys and sorrows with somebody else, then your independence is going to kill you spiritually. You've got to surrender your life to Christ. You've got to seek His kingdom first, not your preferences. If you like to do it on your own, get over it. You've got to connect with others. If you are so interested in your own hobbies or interests or your own career that you don't have time to meet with another Christian or another group, you're going to kill yourself. Your career, your ambition, whatever it is you are pursuing, will kill your spiritual life. You've got to connect. That's why Jesus said this, deny yourself. Pick up your cross and follow me. Who likes to deny themselves? None of us. I want it all and I want Jesus on top. But it doesn't work that way. It's got to be Jesus first and foremost. It's got to be a surrendered life to Him. Candace, he says this, don't call me Lord and then you don't do what I tell you. Who are you kidding? I'm not Lord. If you don't listen to me and obey me, then I'm not Lord. And Jesus wants to be Lord of your life and mine. He is Lord over all. But He invites you and me to make Him Lord of our lives. And He will teach us how to live the abundant life with other believers in a life group, caring, connecting, serving, confessing, until we become mature. God is not through with you and me until we are mature. Does He want you to make a decision for Jesus? Yes. Oh, please make a decision. But that's just the start. Then you've got to enter into discipleship. Then you've got to surrender yourself. Then you've got to get baptized. Then you've got to learn all the things Jesus has been teaching. Then you've got to be equipped to be a disciple. And then you've got to go and make disciples. Who, me? Yes. God is not through with you until you are a disciple maker. And it's not for a privileged few. It's not for those who have a seminary education. In fact, many people who have a seminary education are not disciple makers. They don't know how to meet with others and love others and pray for them and encourage them to confess their sins and mature. You don't need a degree for this, but you do need to be born again. And you do need to surrender to Christ. And you do need to study God's word. And you do need to count and rely on other Christians. Hear me loudly and clearly this morning. I need you, and you need me. We need each other. And Makita, I must confess today, I have failed because we have forgotten how to gather in these life groups. We don't do them well enough. There are some that are working among us, but not nearly enough. Every believer needs that. Every believer needs a faith friend. Every believer needs a group where they belong, where you are known and accepted and encouraged. Don't forsake the gathering of yourselves together, as is the habit of most, not some anymore, most. We don't gather that way anymore. About 100 years ago here in America, we thought we don't need that anymore. We grew out of it. We'll do a couple of affinity groups or a couple of study groups, but we're not going to share our lives in a deeply personal way like that anymore. And you know what happened to our Christianity? It did. Because we thought there could be devotion and true Christianity without discipleship. You cannot. You can't educate your way there. You can't do it on your own. You must belong. You must surrender. You must be supported. So here's my challenge. Pray that God will give you faith friends. Husband, wife, brother, sister, colleague at work. Find somebody that you can share your faith with. Not just golf. Not just fishing. Not just Holly Davidson, motorbike club. No. Jesus in the middle of whatever that is. Where you talk about how are you growing? Where are you failing? What do you need? Where we are open and honest and transparent with each other. Where we rely on each other. And if you're having a bad week, carry where you can say, boy, I don't feel very much like a Christian this week. I've kicked the dog. I swore at my husband. I'm mad at the world. Does that happen? Yes. But share it. Help people know. Help people pray and care for each other. And may we have trust and love for each other that builds us strong. That's what made Methodism unstoppable. And we will not get there again unless we return to our DNA. What is our DNA? I'm glad you asked. Life groups with Jesus in the middle, where we know each other and help each other. Show me how. I don't know. I haven't been greatly successful. I've done some of it, but I'm way behind. I need your help. And I'm praying that every one of our members, nobody's going to be forced. I don't want to be in a life group. That's okay. You don't have to be. It's your choice. Jesus is not going to make you a disciple, force you to be one. He's going to call you and invite you. He's not going to make you a leader. He's going to ask, would you like to be a leader? Because if you would, I could use you. Jesus wants you on his team. Jesus wants to grow you into the best you you can be. But you've got to do his ministry his way. He's got a program. Donnie, it works, but you've got to commit. I've got to commit. Let's pray. Lord, forgive us for trying to do Christianity on our own, for being so independent that we don't want to trust others or tell them about our struggles or our failures or our sins. Help us to learn to love and care and watch over one another with great love. Restore us into that vital discipleship where we are accepted, where we belong, where we mature, where we can say each year, boy, I'm growing deeper and stronger in my relationship with God and in my friendships with others. Don't quit, Lord. Don't give up on us. Complete the good work you've started. Help us to make a decision. Help us to be converted, but then disciple us until we think like Jesus and speak like Jesus and act like Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, help us to get there, we pray. And everybody said, amen.
We'll remain seated as we sing the servant song.
Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. system, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too.
For what am I hoping for? That we will become friends, and more than friends, best friends, and more than best friends, family, brothers and sisters in Christ, that we'll be Christ to each other, that if you need praying for, I'm going to be ready. You might not even ask, I'm already there. If you need encouragement, I'm there. If you need a family for our college students who maybe don't have their family around them, may this become your family. May the MSC become your family, not just a place to eat, not just somewhere where you're welcomed, but family. You can't wait to be there. That's where you belong. That's where you grow. And may we make strangers part of the family. Strangers are just friends you haven't met. Enemies are just friends you haven't met. God can take enemies and make friends out of them. And God can take friends and make family out of them. But it takes connecting. It takes belonging together. So I'm going to ask you to take your spiritual life more seriously. Start praying for faith friends. Start thinking about a life group. If you don't have a group that you're connected to, that you're close to, that are supporting you in your faith, then I want to help you get there. I don't have all the answers, and I can't be the head of every group, but I will do everything I can to help that happen. I would like every member who wants that, to find it, where they really are loved and cared for and known and supported. The little insert that I put in your bulletin, please don't throw it away. Look at those options. The prayer life options and the life group options. Think about that. Pray about it. It's a big deal. Kelly, it's a big deal for our kids, our grandkids, our family. We want everybody to become a vital Christian, not a half-baked, mediocre, lukewarm Christian, somebody that's on fire for Jesus. I'm not quitting until we get there. I'm going to do everything I can. And I must confess again, I have failed because we aren't there. We're still a long way off. But I'm going to do my best. And I know Ramey over here and Mackenzie are committed. They're at the MSC to do that for our students, where they will be known and loved and grow deeper and stronger than they've ever been. Is this important? Yes. Hear me today. May your relationship with God bloom and grow into everything Jesus died to make possible. We're going to sing one more song and then we're going to pray for each other. You can remain seated. Anyone who would like to come forward and kneel here at this chancel rail, that is always appropriate. If you feel that little nudge to do that, please, you run down and you join us right up front here as we bend our knee before God and bow our heads and spend some time taking care of business with God. Nobody's required to do that, but anybody who feels they want to do that, please, don't hesitate. It's a beautiful thing to come and respond in some physical way to what God is saying to you today. Lord, we don't want to be in a hurry as we spend some time with you. Lunch will wait, and the TV program can wait, and another activity can wait. We want to make sure that our lives are right with you, that we are enjoying all that you have made available for us. We want each person to come to a spiritual awakening. We want each person to be born again. We want each person to be filled with your Spirit. And then we want each person to be discipled, so that all that you have taught is learnt and applied to our lives, that all of your gifts and all of your equipment is received, that we can become the men and women, the boys and girls you want us to be. Don't stop, Lord, until we are mature in you, sanctified through and through, body, soul, and spirit. Help us get there, Lord. Show us how. Forgive me for failing and being less of a pastor and a shepherd than I should have been. Help me to be effective for you. We want each person to be mature in Christ. Lord, I want to pray for those who are ill among us. Thank you for our cancer warriors. Be with Cheyenne Woods today as she's fighting for her life. Lord, be with Ron Kincannon as he's undergoing chemo treatments. Donna Henshey as she finished her radiation. We pray that she's cancer-free. Van Heckel is cancer-free. Thank you for helping him. We wrap him up in love and prayers. We pray for Ruth Adams, who's got bone cancer. Please continue to help her. Rowan Lowe, as he's been fighting that brain cancer and cancer in his lungs. Touch him. Be with Donnie Huddleston, Lord. Touch him. Help him and heal him. We've got members who have got Parkinson's, who've got Alzheimer's, who've had strokes. We've got those with artificial limbs and artificial joints. Be with them, Lord. Those who've had amputations. A whole long list of people who need your help, your healing, your touch. Please be with them. Those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, be their comfort and strength. Those who are addicted, we pray that you'll break that addiction, that you'll set them free. We pray for those who are lost and in the far off country, bring them close. Lord, each of us, I know how much you love us. I know how you long to shower our lives with your blessings and your goodness. Help us to respond. Make Victory Memorial a bright, shining Christ light. Make us a blessing center where your love and goodness is shared generously among us. As we pray the prayer you taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to enjoy our YouTube music video together. It's powerful. You'll find the words at the back of your bulletin. It's called I Speak Jesus. And I pray that as you sing along, you'll really sense God's presence and power at work in your life. It's by Charity Gale. Deep, intimate relationship that God longs for. Hear the words of Jesus as he said, Father, may they be one as we are one, you in me and I in you and they in us. God doesn't want to quit until you find that deep, abiding intimacy with himself and all the maturity that a life in Jesus brings. Receive God's blessing and God's challenge as you leave worship and go into the mission field wherever God has placed you. May the Holy Spirit fill us, empower us, and use us as effective servant leaders. May the Word of God dwell richly in us and the grace of God flow into us, making us devoted disciples who welcome the stranger, free the captives, heal the sick, comfort the heartbroken, clothe the naked, visit the prisoners, feed the hungry, and watch over one another in love. Amen.